My name's Rich, and this is Nick, and we've just returned from a round-the-world journey in a tuk-tuk, a small, open-sided, three-wheeled vehicle. Why? What possessed us to do something so stupid?
Well, we all know education's important. It's important for individuals and economies to maximise their potential. But it's more than that. It's a human right. And in the year 2000, world leaders signed up to the Millennium Development Goals, and the education Millennium Development Goal was universal primary education by the year 2015. And although there's been great progress, there's still 57 million primary age children who aren't attending school. Now, to put that into perspective, we're both teachers and we like taking a good register. And if I was going to take a register of those 57 million and said one name every second from now, we'd finish in January the 10th, 2016. So, and that's assuming no one here wants to go to the toilet between now and then.
It's August 2008, and I find myself in Cambodia, the jungle province of northeastern Cambodia, Ratanakere. One Sunday, I stumbled upon a remote school. It was a solitary, dilapidated building full of children eager to learn. There were neat rows of desks and benches, but there were no learning materials of any kind. There were no pens, pencils, books, paper, nothing. There was a blackboard at the front of the class, but no chalk with which to write on it. And there was a teacher sat in the corner of the room, but the teacher didn't even speak the same language as the students in the class.
Now, the shocking truth is this is a success story. These aren't some of the 57 million who are out of school. They're in school. So the global education issues are both quantitative and qualitative. And the more we thought about this, the more really we tried to accept this phrase, that we should just accept what we couldn't change.
But we're also really lucky to have met some incredible local people determined to take action in their own communities. These local people who are facing really quite acute educational and developmental challenges have decided and have chosen to change what they can't accept. Now, seeing these individuals do that, you know, taking it upon themselves to do something, made us think, well, why shouldn't we too?
So we founded the Tuk-tuk Educational Trust, which looks to support the global campaign for education. It looks to promote awareness of global education issues. And really, we wanted to tell stories about local people, grassroots projects, film what they're doing, put them on our website so people can watch those films and donate directly to any projects that they like, knowing that 100% of donations go to exactly what they're watching.
Now, in order to promote the charity and fulfill these goals, we decided to embark upon this expedition. 16 months, 39 countries, 42,120 kilometers. And we're going to try and condense that into just 8 minutes here. So fasten your seatbelts. Here we go.
We started at the British Museum in London and we went from Land's End to John O'Groats. That 3 weeks in the UK summer was the wettest 3 weeks of the whole journey. We headed down into France and into Spain. We met Frodo Baggins. He told us a thing or two about long journeys.
We headed east past the sites of ancient Rome, through the thick forests of Slovenia, through Croatia, and eventually arrived in Greece with only one minor mishap. We woke up in the middle of the night, rather wet. Our things were floating around next to us. It turns out we'd camped just a little bit too close to the sea.
From Greece to Egypt, where we met some new friends and saw some sights. And as we traveled through, we had some amazing camping experiences, all the stars in wild camping in the desert. And we headed back onto road the next morning, and we got arrested by the police on suspicion of espionage. Apparently, we'd been taking photos of secret military bases.
We hadn't. Eventually, we managed to persuade them that we were just teachers, and if we were spies, we wouldn't be traveling in such a ridiculous vehicle. We carried on our way into Sudan, popped the tuk-tuk, hitched a ride in the back of a truck into Khartoum, the capital.
And from the desert and sand of Sudan into Ethiopia, the hills, the mountains, and a new sport was born in Ethiopia called chase the tuk-tuk. And all children throughout Ethiopia chased us on our very slow vehicle.
We crossed into Kenya via Lake Turkana, passing through national parks that were home to lions and cheetahs. It made camping a terrifying experience. In a tent, even the faintest scratching of a dung beetle sounds like a ferocious wild beast. And it was at this stage that we decided if we were camping in a scary scary place. We were going to share a double tent. The logic was that if a lion broke in, hopefully Nick would satisfy their hunger and I'd be fine.
So we had 8 days without any roads, pushing the tuk-tuk. Normally 30 miles an hour is our top speed. Our average speed here was 3 or 4 miles an hour. Luckily, we had some friends with us who helped us push, but also gave us a tow for 8 kilometres through the sand. And we headed down into Nairobi for Christmas.
We moved across to the coast, to Mtwapa, where children, if they wanted to go to school, faced over 15 kilometres on foot to get to the nearest schools. Those who made it there found that they were in classes of up to 150, 200 children in a class. That was until Grace here set up St. Matthew's Junior School. Now, Grace told us about a number of the challenges and struggles that they face. She told us about a recent exam. Children were writing the answers to a question and passing the pencil onto their neighbor, who would then write their answer. That one pencil could go around 5 children. But these children now, thanks to Grace, have access to school. They have access to an education, and they have access to dedicated and passionate teachers.
So from Kenya, we headed into Uganda and saw lots of wildlife as we went. We were pretty scared by most of it. And as we headed through, we got charged by a frisky elephant and headed down into Tanzania, 1,000 kilometers without any roads.
Digging, pushing, pulling, hauling, we made our way along these muddy tracks. Terrifying, considering these little paw prints that we were seeing along the route as well, giving away some of the things, that monsters that were lurking in the forest around us.
And we headed across to Nkata Bay, where we met Alex. Alex runs a shop and still at school, but in his spare time, he runs an educational project. It's a vocational project for elderly widows in a nearby village. When we spoke to Alex, he talked about how the more he learns, the more he wants to teach. And in another village nearby, he teaches children how to make hammocks so they can pay for their school fees. Alex truly was an inspirational guy.
Through Mozambique, across Zimbabwe, made it to Botswana. Botswana elephants, like their Ugandan counterparts, really took a shining to the tuk-tuk. We got into a nice routine as we went, had a couple of minor mechanical issues before eventually arriving at the Cape of Good Hope, the first tuk-tuk to traverse the length of the African continent.
And from South Africa, we headed across to India, 50 degree heat. We went to the factory that we saw where our tuk-tuk got made, but also we had a little lesson about tuk-tuks and how much could be fitted into one tuk-tuk. We saw up to 25 people in one single tuk-tuk, but we headed up past the Taj Mahal, up into the Himalayas and Nepal.
We saw some ingenious ways of fitting extra people onto already overcrowded public transport systems. We visited some schools, and we discovered that Chase the Tuk-Tuk was a game that apparently is very popular here in Asia too.
And so back into India, across to Singapore. And in Singapore, we went north into Malaysia, where we had our first genuine car accident, where a truck plowed into the back of us at 60 miles an hour, knocking us into the other lane.
Luckily, we stayed upright, we didn't flip over, we'd survived, so we carried on up through Thailand, lots of friendly faces, some alternative forms of transport, and we arrived in Laos.
And we tried some of the local cuisine in Laos, various Lion King snacks, bugs, scorpions, crickets, and tarantulas.
While there, we were also privileged to visit the Lao Disabled Women's Development Centre and meet the remarkable founder, Champen. Now, Champen told us about the struggles that she faced, overcoming her physical disabilities and the stigma associated with them in order to access an education. And her tales really inspired us of how she was battling to help other women do the same.
And from Laos into Cambodia, past Angkor Wat and other amazing temples, and into Thailand, where we saw 3 little piggies go to market Thai style.
We boxed up the tuk-tuk, put them on a boat to Colombia. Immediately, we bought local football shirts. We thought these would help us ingratiate with the local police and bandits. Generally, on the whole, they treated us quite well. The tuk-tuk, on the other hand, had other ideas.
Yeah, it started to break first every week and then pretty much every day. And each time, we had to find a different mechanic to try and make sense of the engine. But we also got back on the road, saw some interesting signposts. This one says that I don't shoot people on the road. We turned the corner and hope to see the same signpost again. This one is a particular favourite. I think this says, watch out for the airstrike. We looked up and couldn't see any planes, so we carried on.
A few more mechanical problems, but we made it into Peru. We met Pepe, a young Peruvian guy using surfing to try and engage at-risk youths in education. And we made our way into the deserts in northern Peru.
But here we just, the engine started blowing up and it just problem after problem. And we kept on having to find different people to fix it, and time and money was really racking up. This here is an example of how we help when there's a mechanical problem. But really, we got to the stage where we were running out of money, and we decided that it's probably, if it happens again, we're going to have to go home. But we looked at the world record, and actually, we'd done 37,000 kilometres. We were just 75 short. So we decided if it does happen again, we'll just push it the rest of the way, put it on a boat, and job done.
We set off. 10 minutes later, the engine blew up. So we attached the harness to the front of the tuk-tuk and we set off. 3 days hauling the tuk-tuk through the desert. It was windier and sandier and hillier than we ever imagined it would be, but we finally made our way to the world record mark. Now, like all elite athletes, we set up a finish line using toilet paper. We grabbed each other, we grabbed the tuk-tuk, we hauled it over the finish line, we jumped around celebrating, we high-fived, we had a celebratory hobnob that we'd been saving since we left the UK.
And then the dust settled and we realized we're in the desert with a broken tuk-tuk. So we had to carry on. But luckily, in 4 hours' time, something remarkable happened and a tuk-tuk pulled up in front of us. We hadn't seen one of our types of tuk-tuk since we left India. And these guys pulled off and they said, we know some mechanics. It turns out everyone in this village was a mechanic. And after a few days there, they managed to fix us up and we were back on the road.
We headed down into Chile. We were enjoying our traditional dinners, our traditional suppers. Noodle surprise, as one of our friends affectionately terms them. Noodles, and the surprise being the fact that it is, in fact, just plain noodles. We carried on our way, and it was the Andes that were the last hurdle in front of us.
And this hurdle attached some altitude sickness for the both of us, 5,000 metres above sea level. We got up early in the morning to go down to be in a safe place, and the tuk-tuk also had altitude sickness. Eventually, though, we managed to jumpstart it by pushing it for a few hours, and we headed down into the Argentinian salt flats.
We crossed Argentina, finally arriving in Buenos Aires, the finish line. Now, when we set off from London, we launched from the British Museum, very symbolic of our purpose. By the time we got to Buenos Aires, we were just so hungry that we just stopped at the first steak restaurant that we could find.
We're now going to take you on a journey with us through Africa.
Dreamer lived those ties unbound. I, a quest for peace that, a hopeless search for sweet release. You found your feet, but now they only run to meet a hope that's hanging loosely. Was your crying? Let me out of this cage, for I swear. Mother lets you run and hide, 'cause wisdom knows the eyes through which you cry.
Let me shout to the skies that I
first question that everyone asked us is, what was the best bit?
And we saw some incredible things and had some amazing experiences. But the best thing for us, by far, were the people that we met. And you've heard a little bit about a few of them, but we're just going to take you on a little two-week passage through Africa. This is Kalunda Charles. He is a former street child from Kampala, Uganda. Now, he got off the streets and got a job as a hairdresser. He managed to rent a very small room. And when he did, there was no furniture in this, but he went straight out to the streets, got his two best mates, said, you can stay in my room and have a roof over your head. And they came with him. And he went back to work the next day, and he came back, and there were 10 street children crammed into this room. And so he said to himself, well, I've got to get a better job so I can get a bigger room. And actually, just before we met him, he had four large rooms where almost 100 street children would sleep. And in the daytime, they would be classrooms for a school.
We moved on into Rwanda and into Burundi, and we really started to develop an appreciation of the importance and role of education in promoting peace. In Burundi, we visited the Muyinga refugee camp, and we saw the wonderful work that RET, the Refugee Education Trust, were doing there. In Rwanda, we were privileged to meet Charles and Stephen, two young and courageous survivors of the 1994 genocide. Charles, he was one of 16 survivors of the Niamata Church massacre, where 10,000 Tutsis lost their lives. Everyone he knew, his family, his friends, everyone he knew died in that church that day. Similarly, Stephen lost all but two of his relatives. Now, these young men, instead of being filled with hatred and vengeance, they've decided to devote their lives to promoting forgiveness and reconciliation through their program, Healing Through Arts and Drama. Now, Stephen was talking to us, and he said, the thing about education is it isn't just a matter of academics. It's not about being in school or being in university. It's not simply transferring knowledge from one person to the next. Education is far more. Education is about giving hope. And it's about giving the idea that there's an opportunity to have a better future.
And the other question everyone asks us is, what was the scariest moment? And driving in India was scary, altitude sickness, camping in the wild, they were all really scary. But really, for us, the scariest thing was giving up our jobs and leaving and doing something. And I guess when we started thinking about what we could maybe change, what we couldn't accept, we realized that we couldn't accept that there were still 57 million children, primary age children, who don't have an education. We couldn't accept that it depended upon where you were born and who your parents were, whether or not you even got an education. But what we had to accept was that our generation had failed. We'd failed, and we failed to act together. And it was down to the next generation to start viewing issues such as poverty and education not as issues of charity, but issues of justice.
Before we left the UK, we saw this quote on the London Underground, and it really resonated with us. Nobody made a greater mistake than he who did nothing because he could only do a little. Now, what we've done is certainly only a little. We've driven a ridiculous vehicle a very long way, really slowly. But the people we've met, they've chosen to change what they can't accept. And we hope that their inspirational stories will motivate you to do something, however small, to change what you can't accept.
Thank you very much for listening.